Basically, the topic that I would want to talk about is empowering kids with limited verbal ability to express emotions. So we chose this topic because throughout our conversations during the sessions, I kept talking about, you know, how to kind of, you know, increase emotional vocabulary in children with limited verbal ability. So we thought that we'll take this topic up for my presentation as well. So the intention was to help kids with limited verbal ability to increase their emotional vocabulary using the narrative approach. So some of the key ideas were in working with children was to help them identify the emotion they are experiencing, what actions can they take or generate to manage those emotions. And the reason was that the number of feelings was we know kind of support, it helps us build communication about how we feel in a situation. And kids with, say, limited verbal ability usually don't express that much, you know, especially we take it for granted that they might be not experiencing things, you know, that's the general discourse that you see around. So the idea was to kind of do that. Now, so if emotional vocabulary increases, that in turn increases communication. And when communication and understanding of those feelings increases, then it becomes possible to have preferred interactions. You know, so it very often helps them to communicate more effectively about what they are trying to, you know, what they are feeling. So using the narrative approach, the objective was to let the child have the agency to learn about the various emotions, to develop strategies and to empower themselves in that situation. So we began working with five basic emotions: happy, sad, angry, bored and scared. So I've been able to kind of reach only happy and angry. We're still working on sad, bored and scared. So one of the kids, so this was like a blank sheet that, how does happy look to you? Okay, so one of the kids said happy looks like this. Okay, then we asked that where do you feel it in your body when happy comes to you? Okay. So the thing was this, and they had to kind of color a point, you know, where they feel it in their body. Then it's a little faint. How does happy come to you? So when do they know that happiness has come to them? So the kid whom I was working with, he said that when he gets a surprise, when he makes chocolate, when there are guests over, when he gets to go out, when he watches Tarak Mehta. When he gets food, you know, so that's one correlation. And then when he gets to go to his hometown. So then we asked him that how else, who else gets happy when happy comes to him? So he spoke about his family members, like, you know, Bari Mummy, Dadi, his dad, himself, his brother, his mom, and his some cousin. Then with the same child, he did anger. So what does anger look like? And he drew this and he said, "It's." I said, so what do you want to name some this emotion something? So he's an angry. Then we asked him, where do you feel it when anger comes to you? So he said in the chest. So that's where he covered. What happens when anger comes to you? So he said he bites his finger, he head bangs and he hits his mother. Then what brings anger to you? So when his mom scolds him, when somebody teases him, when he has to do typing because he is in hospitality, so he has to type really long recipes. So and he hates that. So when he has to type, when he has to do math, when food like upma, uttapam and idli are made. And math because he finds it difficult. See, it's fine. Then we asked him that, so this is working on, you know, how to keep anger away. So he could just recollect and put everything down. So are there ways you can keep anger away? So he said that yeah, by being calm. So there's this technique called smell the flower and blow the candle. So he could recollect that and put it down. So basically it's deep breathing. So you, instead of saying you deep breathe where they really can't kind of understand. So we use an analogy of smelling the flower and blowing the candle. So it becomes easier for them to remember. Look outside the window, box the pillow and go for a walk. Some of the things he can keep anger away. And then his happy face was like this. and then what makes him happy. So he wrote about when there are no fights, only food around him, again a correlation, hardworking, and loud music. And who else gets happy? So he wrote mom and dad and everything is nice and pretty. So he wrote that. And sorry, for anger he drew something like this. And what is anger, where does he feel the anger? So he drew this. And what is anger, would you want to give a name? So he named it fire. And so we're still working on it. So and what makes him angry? So a fight, some teasing and fights over laptop. So I started recently with a third kid, and it broke my disposal how happy should look. So when I asked him that, how does happy look, and he drew this. So I didn't believe it first, you know. So I kept asking him that, is this happy? So he kept saying happy, and I'm like, but is this happy? So he's, then I realized that why am I kind of, you know, having a discourse that happy has to be a smile and, you know, something always brimming with like a positive look. But yeah, this is happy. And then I said, where do you feel happiness? Again, breaking a discourse, so he colored the whole thing. So I asked him that, you feel happiness all over? And he said, yeah. So, you know, because I've been, so I had done it to the previous two kids, and I made a mental map that, yeah, so one of them will, I mean, they will point to one of the parts and the fact that he colored everything. So again, it broke the discourse over there.
That's
so thank you to all the teachers. Where are they? Yeah, here. Daisy and yeah, there. Thank you, Jay, for being the most super cool supervisor. Questions? Ask Jay.